I'm Paul Levinson, and welcome to Light On Light Through, episode 395. My friend Patrick Rands, a great DJ on WZBC radio up in Boston, interviewed me just the other day about my novel, It's Real Life, An Alternate History of the Beatles. And I'm going to play that interview for you right now. The timing was perfect because this coming Sunday, October 6th, I'll be doing a meet and greet at a really cool bookstore, Big Red Books, in Nyack, New York, 120 Main Street, this coming Sunday, October 6th, from 12 noon to 2 p.m. But here's the interview that Patrick Rands did with me the other day about my novel. I should say this is the third time that Patrick has interviewed me. A good few years ago, he interviewed me on WZBC radio about Twice Upon a Rhyme. We also talked about science fiction. Back in 2020, he interviewed me about Welcome Up, the album that had just been released on Old Bear Records and Light in the Attic Records. In fact, that was the very first interview that I did about that album. And here then, without any further ado, is the interview that Patrick did with me about It's Real Life, An Alternate History of the Beatles.
The Light on Light Through podcast.
Thanks for tuning in. This week we have a special guest in the studio. Although, well, we're doing it over Zoom. I don't know if that counts as a studio. But I also, I'm actually remote DJ now anyway, so doesn't really matter. But we have Paul Levinson in the studio. We're going to interview him about a new book he just put out this year about an alternate history to the Beatles. So, and then we're going to hear also some, you know, out there Beatles covers later after the interview, and maybe some like John Lennon, you know, some of his stuff too. So here we have Paul here. How you doing, Paul?
I'm doing great, and it's great to be back on your show. This makes the third time, right? And
yep.
And so amazingly, having me on your show the first two times didn't put you out of business. So at least we have that. And I remember that. I think the last time we did that was literally on the edge of COVID. I mean, I remember I was taking the train home, and so we got that right under the wire. And it's great to be back here.
Yeah, it's great to see you. And I'm a huge Beatles fan. Ever since, you know, growing up, I was a Beatles fan. I listened to some of the solo stuff, like John mainly. And I think I had like a Wings record growing up, but like mainly John. So this year, I've actually been listening to the Beatles solo stuff that I never listened to in the past. So I listened to Paul, John, like the outtakes. And then right now I'm listening to George. So this is like perfect timing for me. And I'm always fascinated with the Beatles. Like I still listen to them all the time.
Well, me too. And let me say, you know, about the solo stuff. I don't know if I ever mentioned this to you, but the very first article I ever had published was way, way back in 1971. And there is a music critic by the name of Robert Christgau. I don't know if you've heard of him. I can't stand the guy, to tell you the truth. Classic example of like a self-impressed, you know, self-appointed critical expert. Anyway, he wrote a savage review of Ram, and he attacked the first McCartney album in the review, and it was in the Village Voice, and I used to buy the Village Voice every week, and I read this, and I was so infuriated. You know, I was like 24 years old. I had never had anything published. You know, I'd written and so I fired off this letter to the editor of the Village Voice, and literally, like about a week later, I get a letter in the mail with a check for $65 saying, Hey, Mr. Levinson, thanks so much for sending us that letter. We liked it so much, we're going to publish it as an article in the Village Voice, and we hope that's okay with you. We've included a check. And like, I was like, you know, jumping for joy.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So, and Chris Gow never forgave me. Like a year or two later, he had left the Village Voice, and he had something to do with another like Village, you know, newspaper. And I sent in an article to them about some music thing, and he just like turned it down and said, "This is like worthless trash." So, everything else, he holds a grudge. Hey, Rob, maybe you're still listening to this stuff, but anyway, one of the reasons why I've been thinking just even about that article is one of my favorite Paul solo productions is, Admiral Halsey. You know, that he puts it, "Admiral Halsey notified me, it's across the water." And it's a great song. And I've been listening and watching covers on YouTube. It's a very hard thing to do. I mean, it shows McCartney's genius. He does like 20 different kinds of musical styles just all packed into that.
Well, the crazy thing about that song is, I think it was actually number one back then.
That's right.
Which is like, you listen to that now and you're like, what is going on in this song? Like, how is this number one? Like,
yeah.
But yeah, go on.
Well, no, you're right. It was, McCartney was thrilled with it because it was his first number one as a solo artist after he left the Beatles. And this idea of like what's going on, it was just really an extension of what we begin to see on Abbey Road. Even, I guess, going back to Sgt. Pepper, you know, A Day in the Life, piecing together, you know, two different songs. And he took that to its logical extreme almost and pieced together, you know, God knows how many songs there. But, you know, I've always been, you know, back then I was a little more a fan of McCartney than Lennon. As the years have gone by, I'm more of a Lennon fan than a McCartney fan.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But I have to tell you, I don't know if you know about this apropos of a science fiction author history novel. Paul McCartney had an idea for a musical. I think maybe like right at the end of the Beatles era, you know, shortly before they broke up. And he contacted Isaac Asimov and said, "Hey, I have an idea for a musical. Could you write a science fiction story and I'll put it to music?" And Asimov was thrilled. And basically Asimov, you know, wrote a treatment for a musical, but McCartney didn't like it. And that's why it was never made.
Oh, and that's crazy.
Yeah, but one of the great things about writing an alternate history, I could stick all kinds of things in, things that were almost true but not true. And so in the book, that musical was made, it exists, and some of the major characters go hear a performance of it in Boston.
So, all right, so what's the name of that, the book, actually?
The name of the book is, yeah. It's called, I mean, it's a novel with a title and a subtitle. The title of the novel is It's Real Life, and the subtitle is An Alternate History of the Beatles. And the reason why I titled it that is, you probably know this, the original title of Real Love, you know,
yep.
That the three surviving Beatles got together in the mid-90s, and, you know, with Jeff Lynne producing, made a really nice record of it. In fact, one of my favorite Beatle records. It turns out the original title of Real Love was Real Life. There's a demo that you can hear on YouTube where you hear Lennon sing, "It's Real Life," you know,
yeah,
bang on the piano. And that seemed to me a perfect title, It's Real Life, because what is real life? And in the novel, a disc jockey, Pete Fornatale, the late Pete Fornatale, unfortunately, it's not, you know, 1995, 1996, he's walking through the tunnels under Fordham and gets out and finds that he's in a different reality. And the different reality turns out to be our reality. And we begin to learn because he's thinking of his reality. And so, for example, in his reality, the Beatles never broke up. John Lennon was never assassinated. This Pete Fornatale in the mid-90s never heard of the Traveling Wilburys. He has no idea who Jeff Lynne even is or Tom Petty. So, I have a lot of fun playing with these like alternate possibilities.
Well, even the idea of the remaining Beatles back then recording Real Love is in a way like it could have been a different type of history, because they could have picked a different song. They could have done an earlier version of it, like you said, like instead of doing Real Love, it's, you know, Real Life. So it's funny that way too, like if you think of it that way.
Yeah, and I was thrilled, I'm sure you were too, when Now and Then came out.
Yep.
And one of the things these days about publishing is easy to make little corrections, change things. So I stuck a very brief reference to Now and Then in the novel, which wasn't originally there. So now that the current novel has that in there as well. And it's not the best Beatles song by any means, but it is a really good song, and I'm glad they managed to get it out there. And all this talk about AI drives me crazy. AI is not just Arnold Schwarzenegger, I'll be back. The you can do a lot of good, beautiful things through AI as well.
Oh, definitely. So what gave you the idea to do this to begin with? Like, what led to it?
Well, I'll tell you the truth. I've lived through a lot. I'm a little older than you, and I remember all too well when JFK was assassinated. I was 16 years old, and the 1960s, a lot of great things in there, but it was the decade of assassinations. Then a few years later, Martin Luther King and Robert F. Kennedy. So I grew up with assassinations in the news, but there was always something about the killing of John Lennon that was in a class by itself, because it was like an assassination of music itself. Lennon was political, of course, but that's not why he was assassinated. He was assassinated by a sick guy who was jealous of Lennon's fame and wanted fame himself. And I to this very day, I've never got over that. It just seems wrong to me, that on the cosmic level, that there's something wrong with this universe that you and I and our listeners are now in. A universe, and here you have this group, the Beatles, unbelievable music. I listen constantly to the Beatles channel. Like you, I listen to every cover, I can find on YouTube. It's great. And what happens? Okay, groups break up, but they can get back together. That's not so amazing or surprising or even disruptive, because that's the natural flow. And again, groups do get back together. But what is so wrong is the Beatles ended forever on the day that Lennon was assassinated. So I've been thinking about that ever since then. And the way the novel came to be is, a couple of years ago, one fine day, I just sat down and I wrote a short story called It's Real Life. That short story became the first chapter of the novel. In between those two things, there is a guy by the name of Vin Tese, who was my student in the master's program where I was teaching in the 1980s. And we sort of stayed a little bit in touch. He read the short story, It's Real Life, and said, hey, how about I make a radio play out of the short story? And I said, sure, that's a great idea. And in fact, he asked me to play Pete Fornatello. So I had a good time playing disc jockey in the radio play. And we even got like some covers, some interesting music in there. People can listen to the radio play, but I just do a search on It's Real Life radio play. It's on an internet radio station called Killer Watt Radio. So that's KILLERWATT radio. And it's still up there. And so those two things were done, but that really got me going on the story. And then I sat down like a lunatic and I just like wrote out, made, wrote the novel literally like in a month or two.
Yeah. It's the same thing with me, where It's one of the biggest things that happened to me when I was a kid. I was like, what, 8 or whatever? But I was already a huge Beatles fan. I was already a John Lennon fan, even. Like, I listened to his solo stuff. So when, and I think back then things were just almost more shocking too, because, we didn't have as many like nowadays nothing's shocking in a way. But like back then it was like just a huge shock that suddenly he was assassinated. And yeah, like it changed history.
It did. And ultimately, I mean, the relationship, sociologists have this fancy word, parasocial relationships. I don't think like the word para because it sounds almost like alien or whatever. And it's a very, very real thing. Obviously, we human beings are capable of loving people and what they do that we don't know at all personally. And that's why these things are so upsetting. It's like we lost part of our lives then. And you're right, as an independent artist, Lennon had already done in the 70s all kinds of remarkable things. I think, for example, Jealous Guy is just like one of the all-time best Lennon and Beatles songs. Just like very thoughtful lyrics and very good music. And in addition to everything else, I live in New York City. And my wife and I and our kids still live here, and we and grandkids. We know that it's not the safest place in the world, but to me, every time I read something like, and they blame Yoko, it's not her fault, but you say, had it not been for Yoko, Lennon never would have left England, but there is a truth to that because here in the United States, there are a lot of wonderful things about our country, but the rest of the world correctly thinks we're insane when it comes to guns. And any psycho can go in and buy a gun, and unless the psycho went to a shrink, and that was reported publicly, hey, too bad. The Second Amendment, you're entitled to go get a gun, and that's something else that bothers me about the whole assassination of John Lennon.
That's a good point. So then you wrote this book, then what happened?
So I wrote the book, and first of all, this because actually you and I met for the first time, I think, at Boscone, a science fiction convention. Some of my science fiction, and some of them have been published by really big publishers, but like every other author who's not an absolutely Stephen King best-selling author, I've never been happy with what big publishers have done with my book, or to be even more precise, I always felt they could have done more, with whatever novel came out. And I once had a discussion with Tom Doherty, who was president of Tor Books when my first novel came out. I said, we really love your first novel, The So Code. It went on to win the Locus Award for Best First Science Fiction Novel. And he said, what would you like us to do for your novel? And I said, well, how about a full page ad in the New York Times? And he looked at me and he said, well, I can understand why you say that, but that wouldn't do the novel any good. It'd only be stroking your ego. And he went on to tell me something which is true, that even back then, surveys showed that over 90% of the reason that people give when they buy a book is not because they've seen an ad or spotted it in a bookstore or anything like that. It's because a friend or a family member has raved about the book to them. So he said, all this would be doing is stroking your ego. It wouldn't really help. We'd sell a couple hundred copies. And I said, well, hey, stroke my ego. So over the years, I've begun exploring smaller companies no one ever heard of. So, for example, the sequel to The Plot to Save Socrates was published by Josara Media, a small company in Texas. And when I finished the novel, I went to a couple of agents, and I've had agents on and off. And as an author, and like every author has their own opinions about it, to some extent, all things being said, I think I've done better off without agents than with agents. because they, in my opinion at least, they don't come through for you when you really need them. Without giving any specific names, I had a nonfiction book, one of my nonfiction books published by a big publisher in England, and the contract called for them for pu to publish the hardcover and then a soft cover. And the hardcover didn't sell that well, I think because they didn't promote it, but nonetheless. But the contract called for them to nonetheless, after a year, publish a paperback. They didn't do it. And so I asked my agent, I said, well, could you get the publisher to fulfill their, part of the contract? And he said to me, okay, but you have to understand, you are not our only client. This is our agent. We can't antagonize this publisher. So I'll ask in a nice way. We'll see what happens. Long story short, nothing happened. A couple of years went by. I finally ran into my original editor at that publisher who had left the publishing company. I told him the story, and he said, well, that's outrageous. I'm going to contact the head of the company. And through that, the paperback of that, and it has the word real in it. It's called Real Space. I have a thing with the word real. So anyway, they published this, the paperback. It did pretty well. But then it came time for me to get, royalties for that book. And the publisher calls me and says, we know that you're the one who worked this out, but the original contract was done through your agent. We have to send the money to your agent. And then you're asked. I said, okay. So they send the money to my agent. I get a check from my agent minus the 20%. That's the agent's cut. I called him and said, what is this 20% you're taking? You did nothing. You refused to do anything. I got it through myself. Don't you have the decency? Wasn't even that much money. He was like, maybe it was like a couple of $1,000. I mean, it was some money, but not a huge amount of money. And he said, well, sorry, read the contract. So I said, okay, I'll read the contract. And I looked at the clause where it said any either party can cancel the contract on any notice, and that's what I did. So I've gone in and out. I've been at this for a long time. Gone in and out of relationships. I talked to a couple of agents with a possible idea of their fronting the book and going around see if they can make a deal. But the whole thing was taking too long. The other thing is, the older I get, the more impatient I get. And when I write something, I want it to come out. And so I went with a small company, Connected Editions, and that's how it's published. That happened, I guess the novel was finished in the summer of 2023. And, in my opinion, I futzed around for about 6 months, thinking maybe I'll go with a bigger publisher or get a big agent, and finally went with a small publisher. And I'm happy to say the book is doing very well. So
Oh, awesome.
yeah, I'm happy with it. And I might write a sequel of it. A couple of people have said to me, this might make a good movie or even a limited television series. But one of the things I found the hard way in this business is, don't ever talk about anything specifically until the contract is actually signed, because otherwise you make a fool of yourself.
Yeah, and probably even then, like you said, they can cancel the contract. So
That's
even
right.
if you could be like, oh yeah, it's getting done. Oh wait.
Exactly. It's gotten much easier though now. I mean, one of the really great things that's happened just in the past really 20 years, it used to cost a fortune to make a movie. And it still can cost a lot of money if you're like shooting a movie in the Himalayas or something like that, getting the crew and the equipment over there. But if you're making a movie or a television series in any kind of a big city, it's much less expensive than it used to be. So that's a good thing. So who knows? Well, not by the time people are listening to this, that nothing happens that quickly, but sometime in the next 6, 7 months or a year or two, there might be something in
One thing I
theory.
thought was interesting was how once you realize that maybe you're in an alternate history or alternate time or whatever, that changes history too. Like it becomes this like What's a word for that? I don't even know. Like, where you're cognizant of the change. Like, didn't that happen to the main character?
Right. I don't know if there's a word for it. It is a good concept. I mean, that's an excellent question because there are all kinds of ways that you can take alternate history. So for example, in terms of what you're saying, you could have somebody step into an alternate history and not remember who they are
Right.
because they're in a world that they don't come from in the first place. There's also the question of what do you do with the original person in the alternate history? So Pete Fornatel, we first see him in the alternate history where the Beatles are still together in the mid-90s. Lennon wasn't assassinated, but Pete has this feeling of dread, this sort of, inchoate feeling of there's something really wrong every time he hears the song Real Love. And I'm sorry, every time he hears, I'm getting confused myself, every time he hears the song Real Life in this world. And and then just by walking through these tunnels under Fordham, which by the way, the tunnels really exist. I don't know if they take you into alternate realities, but Edgar Allan Poe, believe it or not, may have had something to do with the tunnels because he had a cottage not that far from Fordham University in the 1840s and 50s, right when the university was created. But there is a real question of Pete finds he's in an alternate reality, our alternate reality, in which the Beatles no longer exist in the 1990s. Lennon was killed, 1980, et cetera, et cetera. But I made the decision because I thought it would be more interesting to just have the Pete from his original reality, in which Lennon survived and the Beatles continued, have all that knowledge in the new reality, which is our reality, because that makes it more interesting. He's looking around all the time and being surprised. In fact, pretty early on in the second chapter of the book, not to give too much away, he's at the radio station, and the secretary is thrilled about this artist in the 1990s, Tom Petty, because again, it's our reality, right? But Fornatel has no idea who Tom Petty is. And so so the secretary says, "Why don't you play some Tom Petty?" And Pete says, "Who's Tom Petty?" And then a little later, Tom Petty actually calls Pete and says, "Hey man, I'm really enjoying your show, but you're not playing any more music. What's going on?" And Pete doesn't know what to say because he doesn't really know who Tom Petty is.
Here's an idea. You mentioned Edgar Allan Poe. You could do like a another like a go back in time to when Edgar Allan Poe was around and create an alternate history back then. That'd be interesting.
Well,
Like,
absolutely. And Poe is a fascinating character. I just did an interview a couple of months ago, and your listeners can find it on my podcast, Light On, Light Through, and also on my YouTube page. And he has written a book about Edgar Allan Poe. And in fact, he goes around and gives lectures about Edgar Allan Poe. And he is extremely interested in how Edgar Allan Poe died, which is still a very, very controversial topic. And there are all kinds of theories about how he died. And that's a situation that cries out for alternate history, as you're suggesting. There's more than ample evidence that, who knows, maybe he didn't really die and lived on in another.
oh, really?
I mean, well, it's just that, it was a long time ago, and the records that they kept back then were not all that precise. So yeah, that's a good story right there for sure.
It's funny because I was really into like classic rock growing up, and I like new music too, but I was a real Beatles fan and also like a Jimi Hendrix fan. I actually wrote a story I mean, it was probably only 2 pages, where I went back in time and I saved Jimi Hendrix.
That's great. See, you and I think alike.
I wonder if I still have it around, too. It'd be funny to dig that out.
Well, you should dig it up. You know, it's very easy to get published and get paid for it without even going to a traditional magazine. There are a couple of sites like that. Substack is one of them. I actually use a site called Vocals, V-O-C-A-L, where you join for free and you can publish your story there. And then you promote it, and then you get paid a certain amount every time somebody reads the story. So that sounds like a great idea for a story. You should definitely send it out. And, you know, discovering things that you started writing or even finished writing years ago is a time-honored thing that authors do all the time. You know, in a way, I started writing It's Real Life. You know, the instant that I heard that John Lennon, you know, had been shot and killed on that horrible day in 1980.
It's also interesting because just the idea, like John Lennon took like, what, 5 years off from music? But that's, I think when he wrote Real Life, he was trying to live real life. But like, as a rock star, you know, you don't even know who you can trust. Like, You hear weird stories like in the news, like there was something about like a watch he had that like someone like either stole from him. I forget the exact details, but like, who do you trust like as a rock star? So like, what is his real life really like, you know, back then? And like that song, in a way, like the way it morphed from real life to real love, like it reflected his actual life back then. He was trying to write about his real life.
I think you're completely right. You know, it's interesting. He was writing about his real life, including being aware that people, and especially critics, and probably Robert Christgau, for all I know, were attacking him during those years where he wasn't writing music. That's why he wrote that song, "People Saying and Acting My Life Away." I'm just sitting here watching the wheels go.
Yeah.
Wrong key for me, but that's what he was talking about, that people were saying he's wasting his time. He's sitting there, you know, watching the wheels roll by, not really doing anything. You know, they're saying I'm really off the ball. And it's one of my favorite of his solo songs.
Yeah.
I heard a story, and I don't know whether this is true or not, it probably is true, that, you know, as you know, the Double Fantasy album was the last thing he recorded. And, you know, that was released right around the time Lennon was killed. And they had been planning a huge tour, at very least across the United States, with a whole bunch of really talented sidemen who were really looking forward to that. And you talk about history changing. You know, the death of Lennon just knocked that out. And that tour never happened. And Lennon's songs were still, you know, on that album, well enough played and well enough known, but they would have had that much more importance if he'd gone on that tour.
Oh, I know. I think the 80s would have been a totally different decade with John Lennon around.
That's right.
And yes. there is one thing I read recently that I think Keith Richards from the Rolling Stones said, like, John Lennon was like a true musician. And I think that's also like what you're saying, like where he would have been together with a bunch of musicians that, like, you know, wanted to be on that tour. As opposed to like, it's interesting when you compare to like Paul, like he kind of got like a bunch of like, I don't know, second rate musicians around him in Wings. You know what I mean? Like I feel like the way they did their solo careers were even different.
Yeah, I agree. Although as far as Wings is concerned, what's the guy? He died very recently. He started out in the Moody Blues, and he was good enough. But right, the other musicians were. And what happened to the guitar player who's like a blonde guitar player? He wasn't bad. And then he left.
Was he the one that? There was one guy who died in the late '70s.
Yeah, I think that was the guy. But yeah, I mean, this thing about dying and what would have happened, I mean, that's in itself, there are dozens of stories and novels in there. It's just a question of who you want to focus on. Phil Oakes, for example, was a folk singer who most people who were listening to Dylan and Oakes at the same time in the mid-1960s, and my wife and I were among those people, we thought that Oakes and Dylan were pretty much on a par, and different, but and Oakes had like some brilliant songs, some brilliant anti-war songs, and he had a really tragic end. He took his own life in the mid-1970s, and so when you're thinking about, well, and this sort of applies to Lennon, what would these thinkers, because they were thinkers who were musicians, what would they have said, about the world that evolved, and would it have evolved? I mean, I would love to hear what John Lennon and Phil Oakes would have to say about Donald Trump. And not that we don't have, Bruce Springsteen, I think is a brilliant musician, but the loss of people on that level does have a major impact that deflects the popular culture. The problem, of course, by the way, which I deal with somewhat in the book, but it's always there when you are in any way trying to change anything in time. So your story, about somebody going back in time and saving Jimi Hendrix, the problem of unintended consequences always emerges, and you have no idea before you do something. You might plot it out, but you have no idea how it's going to play one way or the other. And logically, there's no way to prove how it's going to go, so you have to do it and then suffer the consequences. But my novel isn't, I mean, not to give too much away again, Pete comes to realize that it's one thing being in alternate realities. It's quite another stopping Lennon's assassination in our reality. And he needs to find out, well, how many alternate realities are there? And in how many of those realities was Lennon killed? And being in an alternate reality is not the same as going back in time, which then creates an alternate reality. Pete gets into an alternate reality in a different way. Again, the tunnel under Fordham. Boy, Fordham University is going to have an increase in student enrollment when word gets out about this tunnel. But yeah, so I mean, that's really, to some extent, even another story, speculating as to how, even the smallest change in an alternate reality makes that reality so much different from our reality.
Yeah, I don't think like Paul didn't play with like the you were talking about the musicians, like the real musicians. Paul didn't really play with any real musicians until the 80s. Like
Right.
with Michael Jackson, for instance.
Right. Or even Elvis Costello,
Oh yeah.
Red Face. They actually wrote that song together, and he played a little bit with him.
And Ebony and Ivory.
That's right. Yeah. You could say again, so the Beatles would have broken up regardless of what happened to Lennon, because one thing had nothing to do with another. But had Lennon survived, I think that sooner or later the Beatles would have gotten back together again, and who knows what would have happened.
I just saw a video that said that just on Paul McCartney's website, there's some kind of interview where he said John actually called him and asked, like, let's get back together. And Paul said no. And it's like buried on his website somewhere. And some guy on YouTube discovered this and was like, wait a minute, this could have changed everything. What happened here? I
So
just
what?
saw
Yeah. When
a
did
pretty
this
good,
happen?
I don't know. There's a YouTube video that just went up like a few weeks ago. And he just noticed it on the Paul McCartney website. And I don't, I, he didn't really say when the interview was. Maybe in the 80s, I'm not sure. But isn't
Yeah.
that crazy? Like, wait, John called him and it was like, hey, let's get back together.
Well, there is a story. They worked together about so Saturday Night Live, I think, started like in the mid 70s or something like that. Hall was in New York, maybe even in the Dakota with John, and they were watching Saturday Night Live. And they looked at each other and said, "Hey, why don't we go down there? You know, I'm sure Lorne Michaels will put us on the show." And they were this close to going down to Rockefeller Center in New York and going on the show and, you know, maybe singing Two of Us. That was it, actually, I think, about Paul and Linda, but yeah, a lot of people thought it applied to Paul and John. But for whatever reason, they decided not to. And I don't know who's, maybe it was Paul who said no. It's unfortunate. I mean, look, it's not, there's no doubt that George was very bitter about how at least John and Paul had treated him. And I think he had something of a point. I mean, near the end of the Beatles, George was writing songs that were as good as John and Paul's. I mean,
Yeah, I think, well, the perfect example is the song "Isn't It a Pity?" Like, it sounds like the perfect Beatles song that never happened.
that's
You know what
right.
I mean? Like, I could totally hear that song with that kind of Beatles, you know, it's a little more like the release version's more kind of like the band or whatever, but like I could hear that kind of jing jing, you know, that kind of Beatles sound. I it totally never happened, and I could like, of course, George is going to get upset after a while with all that kind of stuff happening.
Yeah, I mean, look, All Things Must Pass, I think, is one of the greatest songs that any of the Beatles wrote.
Yeah.
And you hear them rehearsing it in even in the original Let It Be and in Peter Jackson's thing as well. They're sitting around, it's not yet fully together, but why didn't they work on it more? I mean, it was a brilliant, brilliant song. And that in the original Let It Be that was released, you know, the movie in the early 1970s, I guess, that's where they have the argument right after they're playing the song, they do, and then they decide to do something else. And George is in a really bad mood. And that's when George says, "Well, just tell me what you want. Do you want me to play this, you know, in the studio?" And look, I mean, Paul and John were obviously at their peak then as well, but there's also a story that certainly John, but even Paul, were jealous about something, which many people correctly regard as one of the Beatles' greatest songs.
I mean, we've been in bands, and we like people change when they're in a band. Like George was like getting into that kind of stuff with Bob Dylan and the band, and you know, maybe Paul and John weren't as into that sound. It could have been something that, like that.
Yeah, that's right. Frank Sinatra just like added salt to the wound by saying his favorite Lennon and McCartney song is something.
Oh,
So
really?
Frank was an expert on the Beatles. So it's no wonder that George, you know, was upset. But George was the one also, though, in the 90s who refused to work on Now and Then. And it's thought
Really?
that, yeah, that the lyrics of Now and Then really is, it's a love song that John wrote about Paul, that now and then I miss you, but he knows that, you know, they'll always be together in some sense. And I think Paul thought and thinks that song was about him. That's why he was so keen, you know, to get it out and make it the final Beatles song. Although, you know, there's still some George Harrison songs that haven't been record yet, so it might not be the final Beatles song.
Yeah, we can only hope.
That's right. I'm going to be very interested to see what to hear what songs you're going to choose. You mentioned at the beginning to play after this interview what songs by individual Beatles you're going to play.
Well, you'll have to wait and see.
I know
So.
you have very good taste in music. You're the one who told me, you may remember the first interview, that some, I don't know, some group in Europe or something had put out a version. No, they didn't put out a version. They put out the original Ring Around My Rosie, right? Or was it Merry Goes Round? I don't remember which one it was. On an album and didn't even tell me about it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You said, "By the way, you know, there's a version out there that's on some record albums." I said, "Really? I know. I didn't hear about that."
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah, those were crazy times back then when I was getting into all that bubblegum music.
Yeah. Well, it's good music. They bubblegum music.
That's one thing. There's a Beatles channel. There needs to be a bubblegum channel. If there is, I don't know if there is one, but I don't think so.
That's a good idea. That's a great idea. Well, if you devoted your show, if there were just a show, seriously, then all you did is bubblegum, it would receive notice.
Oh yeah, I've done that. I've done like an hour of bubblegum every once in a while.
Yeah, group in California. The two main people in the group are Robbie Rist, who was in the
Oh
boy
yeah.
band, played the cousin Oliver, and Don Frankel, who actually played some good keyboard in my original Twice Upon a Rhyme album, and then I got him back to do some keyboard in the Welcome Up album. So the two of them, they created this group, and they recorded a new version of Merry Goes Round. That sounds pretty good. So, that bubblegum thing still lives. The other thing that you might be interested in is the guy who wrote Ring Around My Rosie,
Yeah.
David Fox, no relation to Ed Fox from Twice Upon a Rhyme. He's still alive and kicking. He's on Facebook. I haven't had a chance to listen to it yet. He sent me some tracks from a new album.
Oh,
He
wow.
lives, if you want, in fact, you can just do a search on him. If you want, I can introduce you to him. I'll tell him that you're a disc jockey and you might be interested in, interviewing him or whatever. He's the guy who wrote Ring Around My Rosie and Pink Hippopotamus. You know that
Oh, wow.
song, right? That was the B
Yep.
side.
Yep.
And they were both satire songs. He didn't really mean them seriously.
No.
It just so happened that we walked into Herb Abramson's recording studio up on the 70s, and Herb had just recorded some of their music, and they were very frustrated. And Herb said to them, I might be able to find some people who can produce this, because they weren't producers, they were just a group. And we were like the next people who walked in. And Ed said, "Yeah, sure, we can produce it." And that's how Ring Around My Rosie.
That's perfect. That's how I picture those bubblegum records getting made.
Yeah, I know. They were good. They had good music to them. I'm surprised that Paul McCartney never did a bubblegum song, or maybe he did, because he had a habit of anytime he heard something on the radio that was a hit, he tried to see if he could do it himself, and usually he did, and he did it pretty well.
And
But
he's still going strong.
yeah, that's right. Even though his voice is a little hoarse, but what do that's what you get, I guess, if you smoke and sing your heart out for all. He sang Helter Skelter, one time too many, where he
Well,
screamed.
he's always getting wasn't he always getting busted for having pot at airports and stuff?
Yeah. The only time he was away from Linda was once when he was in Japan. He was arrested. He was supposed to fly home, and he was arrested because he had marijuana in his possession, and he had to spend a night or two in jail in Tokyo. So they have that distinction. I shouldn't say anything, though, negative about Japan, because as I keep telling people, I am, as a musician, more popular in Japan than I am in the United States.
Well, they have good taste over there.
Yeah, I think so. Absolutely.
Right, so to wrap things up, do you want to say anything else about the your it's life book,
Yeah.
real life?
Let me just say, I am going to be doing an event at a great bookstore here in the New York area. It's called Big Red Books, and it's actually an incredibly cool bookstore, because the owner, a really nice guy by the name of Richie, is also a musician. So he loves books, novels about musicians. On October 6th, from 12 to 2 p.m., I will be meeting and greeting people in Nyack with copies of my novel. And believe it or not, Richie found another guy who wrote yet another novel about John Lennon and the Beatles, and he'll be sitting next to me. So anyone
Oh,
who's a
awesome.
Beatles fan, come by October 6th. Nyack is a great town, by the way, if you've never been there. It's like one of the coolest towns in the world. They have great restaurants, they have nightclubs, jazz, you know, bookstores, all kinds of things. So that's October 6th in Nyack, Big Red Books, from 12 to 2. And, you know, we go up to Cape Cod every year, and Tina, my wife's sister, lives in Boston. So any bookstores in Boston, I'm happy to come by and do an event at your store as well, and a reading, a signing, whatever.
Yeah, we got to get you up this way.
You and I and Carl were, again, it was right before COVID, we were planning on getting together and doing some songs, including a couple of songs from Welcome Up, and then the COVID curtain came down.
Yep.
How's Carl doing? I mean, is he...
Oh, he's great.
All right. Well,
yeah.
Give him my best regards. But are you two still playing music together at all? Or?
No. Yeah, I don't really see him as much now because we both remote DJ. So,
why did you do that, by the way? Because it was just easier than, or was it because of COVID also? Or?
Well, yeah, it started with COVID, but then, yeah, it's just easier to just do it from home.
Yeah.
You don't have to truck all the way over to the station every week.
Yeah. Well, that makes sense. Well, I'm really glad that your show and the station are still going strong. So,
yep. Yeah, Carl still has a show before mine, and he loves it. He loves DJing from home.
Well, you do too, I assume, right?
Oh, yeah. But it's funny because he actually plays, like, he uses records. And, like I think he has two record players, and he does it live, basically. Not, you know, it's like live, record it live, and then he'll put it up.
Yeah. What was his name? Gold Boy or something? Wasn't that?
Gull's Window Circus. And then his band is Gull Boy. Yeah.
All right. Well, one of these, I'm not going to say one of these days or even one of these months, but one of these years, we should revive that, the three of us, and see, you know, what we sound like. We can do at least some three-part harmony.
Yeah, definitely.
A couple of Beatle covers. Who knows?
Yeah, we definitely got to get your book up here. You know, you're doing a book stop up here somewhere
yeah.
at a bookstore.
Well, listen, if you want to set something up, I'm good to do it anytime. And I'll certainly let you know if I get anything going in the Boston area. You know, I'm still a professor at Fordham, so it's not quite as easy, you know, unless it's the summer. But the summer is always easy because for most of the summer, we're up on Cape Cod anyway, which is just an hour and a half from Boston.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll have to look at next summer then.
All right, good. All right, great talking to you.
Yeah, it's great to talk to you too, Paul.
All my little plans and schemes lost like some forgotten dream. Seems that all I really was doing was waiting for you. Just like little girls and boys playing with their little toys, seems like all they really were doing was waiting for love. It's real love, it's real, yes, it's real love, it's real. From this moment on, I know exactly where my life will go. Seems that all I really was doing was waiting for love. Don't need to be afraid, no need to be afraid.
Hopefully you enjoyed that interview I did with Paul Levinson about his new book, It's Real Life, An Alternate History of the Beatles. Very interesting concept. You know, you always want to
change history when something big like that happens, like a John Lennon assassination or Jimi Hendrix dies. And this is a cool version of Real Love by Ann Reburn. Hopefully next year we'll hear from Paul again.
The Light on Light Through podcast.
And I hope you enjoyed that interview that Patrick Rands did with me. Wasn't that cover of Real Love by Ann Reburn beautiful? She has such a wonderful voice and great harmony. If you look at the show notes to this episode, you will get a link to the complete version of her rendition of Real Love. It's up on YouTube. And she is a really fabulous singer who has her own songs and does covers of Beatles songs, all kinds of other great songs. She does a wonderful cover of Roy Orbison's You Got It. You'll see it all on YouTube, and again, I'll have a link to her music in the show notes of this episode. Also, in Patrick's interview with me on WZBC Radio the other day, he followed the interview with some really wild music by Yoko Ono. And what I'm going to do is put a link to that music as well in the show notes to this episode. So there's lots of great music out there for you if you're in the mood for it. And I'll be back here soon with another episode of Light On, Light Through. We have some great interviews coming up and some reviews of some great new science fiction on television. In the meantime, stay safe, stay sound, and enjoy.
The Light On, Light Through podcast.
Athens, 2042 AD. She ripped the paper in half, then ripped the halves, then ripped what was left again into bits and pieces of history that could have been. Sierra Waters had read once that, years ago, it was thought that men made love for the thrill, while women made love for the sense of connection it gave them.
Curled Up with a Good Book says, Sierra Waters is sexy as hell. You can find out more about The Plot to Save Socrates by Paul Levinson at theplottosavesocrates.com.
Your brilliant story, it's real life.
Paul Levinson still codes about an ancient biotech war raging on in secret for centuries.
Reading words from Paul Levinson's mind. His tales take the stage, leave the world.